All right, we're back, guys. Welcome back to CSR Cup 5, Snimch. And we are here with TJ, who just arrived, and Forsen, who has not prepared for this tournament, but somehow got invited and is going to play and melt some faces. Is that it?
Yes, that is it.
Perfect. Perfect.
For sure.
Sounds good. But before we actually talk about the tournament and the matchups and the lineups, some sellout stuff, guys. So I want to talk about the sponsors first. Well, even before the sponsors, let's go to the Facebook page. We do have the Facebook page for Take TV, and that might interest you because there is a raffle, yo. Exclamation mark raffle, SSC5 raffle. You can go here, click on it, and enter the raffle. And there's some cool stuff you can win. TJ, would you like to win some stuff?
I would love to win some stuff.
Perfect. And following on the sellout, we have Need for Seat, one of the sponsors. Thanks so much for sponsoring us. The seats, the chairs are great. I've been using one for some time, and they're pretty good.
Are you guys downstairs?
Yeah, there's a lot of those chairs downstairs, and like Seat Story Cup, the name basically derives from those kind of chairs for Need for Seat, and they're really good. They're really good, definitely. Then we have Logitech, one of our sponsors, and they also create some peripherals, keyboards, mouses, and we actually have some Logitech stuff here as well. So. Let's take this. So, Forsen, if you can hold it for like the whole, just keep it.
Just like this.
Yeah, keep holding it while we cast.
Like, my favorite keyboard.
Just never let it go, dude.
I'll never let it go.
You have
all
to
day.
Have
I love this shit so much.
All day. You have to carry it around all day. Stand right off to the side of the camera the whole day.
Okay.
Yeah, that's perfect. All right, thank you, Forsen.
Awesome angles.
All right, going back, we have Sennheiser, one of the sponsors as well. Really good headphone stuff. So, are you guys using Sennheiser? You're using one right now. How do you like the experience?
I love it. It feels like there's a comfortable sock wrapped around my entire head.
Yeah, it's just...
That I can hear things out of.
Soothing and really like a glorious voice. Oh, wait, that's my voice. But it comes really well with Sennheiser.
Disclaimer,
as well.
Sennheiser headsets at home don't come with Nimsch voice.
Yeah, they don't. They don't. But they might if you listen to CSR Cup 5. And then we have Macherino, one of our newer sponsors. And this one is really important, guys, because you can actually... increase the prize pool of this event. If you donate here, we have some stretch goals. I think the stretch goals have not been announced yet, but let's say some of the stretch goals will be like Forsen shirtless cast, or like, I don't know, Reynard coming in and casting again. So some of the cool stuff can happen if you actually donate. I cannot say exactly what will happen. We'll have the stretch goals later, but you can influence the prize pool yourself. So thank you so much for Macherino for giving us this opportunity. And now back to the cast. Have you not really prepared for the tournament? I just can't believe it, dude. Like, have you played one game of Hearthstone at least?
No. Dude. I haven't played in, I think, a couple of weeks or something.
All right. Do you know, like, there is a new expansion, by the way? Like, was
yeah, okay. yeah. I heard about it.
Right.
So if you win, it's going to be incredible.
It's going to be insane.
It is. My vote's on you.
Yeah, me too.
All right.
Rooting for
I would
myself.
Hope so.
Well, me and TJ, we've been playing a lot. And you know who's playing? There's Froden versus Elstkaka. And they both won the previous match. Elstkaka 3-0 with Freeze Mage versus JJ. And Froden versus Strifecrow. I said Froden is going to get wrecked, but he actually played really well.
Yeah, I was actually surprised he 3-0'd Strifecrow. I came into the game when it was 2-0 already. And I was, I didn't expect that. But then again, he did it last time as well, right? He had a hard group. Lost history and he...
Top 8 in the end, I think. Yeah. So, really impressive from Froden.
With Meme Shaman as well. Not only that, but the only two golden cards in his entire deck are the Bog Creepers.
That's super cool, right?
That's style points right there. Dan's man, it's all about style, even when he builds his decks.
Yeah, Kappa Pride. And now we have Dan actually banning the Freeze Mage from Elstkaka, so we will not see that deck. Elstkaka, though, bans a Warrior from Froden. But the start is this Conceit Shaman again from Froden versus Warrior.
I think Dan didn't really have a choice but to ban the mage. The Freeze Mage from Elstkaka, just because like all of his decks are bad. He's got a rogue, and no matter what rogue it is, it's going to be bad against the Freeze Mage. And obviously his Shaman as well is going to be pretty poor against Freeze Mage, as we saw earlier.
Yeah.
With Super JJ.
Yeah, he lost. Even though he had Malygos, he still lost the matchup. But this is the new Warrior, guys. This is the combo Warrior with Worgen's charging your face for 40, 50, up to 60 damage, I've heard.
Yeah, the OTK Worgen actually, it was around like a long time ago. And then I don't know what happened to the deck. Did someone make like a change to it? Because I never saw it when I was playing recently.
So the Worgen, it was I actually played at NA Champs, I think, in winter, and then the deck just became bad. So right now there's the new version that works. Like at some point,
yeah. What's the difference between the new version and the old version?
I think the new version mostly plays Pyromancer with Commanding Shout, so you have more opportunities to just clear the board. It doesn't. So the previous version was more brawl dependent. It was like a Control Warrior with one combo. You still had a lot of draw, but you mostly tried to brawl the board and clear the board as much as possible. With this deck, you mostly have those Pyromancers when you still clear the board, but without Brawl, you just have build up.
And now there's just better cards too. Like Ravaging Ghoul is just such a powerful warrior card right now.
Yeah.
I mean, not even right now, it's going to be powerful for until it rotates out, so. Got a couple new tools, new fancy tools.
So what do you guys think about this matchup? Because overall, when I'm thinking Worgen, like Worgens, they do have to charge face. And if there is a taunt in the way, it's kind of troublesome.
I mean, it doesn't really care though about all the healing in the deck because he's OTKing, right?
Yeah.
And it does have his executes and stuff for removal. So, I mean, I think this should be favored in the Warriors because the Shaman deck is so slow that the Warrior has all the time in the world to get his combo, right?
Makes sense. Like sometimes you don't even care about the taunt because you have Commanding Shout, so you can charge your Worgen into a taunt, kill it, and then charge phase again. So it's actually a pretty cool deck overall. I played like on ladder, it's getting more and more popular. Some pros play it a lot, like Life Coach, Pokrovac. Have you seen it on NA being played as well?
Not as much, no. Decks take a lot longer to pick up on NA. I wonder why. Who knows why? But yeah, I think this matchup's like a race. It's like a race to see if the Shaman deck can get like a big Ancestral Spirit on a taunt. Because those can be really hard to get through. Yeah, they have executes, but if they like stack it enough, if they put down multiple taunts or if they Ancestral Spirit an Earth Elemental, like how do you get through that as the Worgen OTK?
And the Faceless could be used, though, like to copy an already Ancestral Spirited Faceless.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
Earth Elemental.
Because then they like have to have Hex.
Yeah.
That's a good point. But what's the maximum amount of damage the Worgen OTK can do?
I've heard up to 60. Like, the standard is 40 because
you We're talking about one Emperor reduction here?
Yeah. So
it's a Worgen, double Inner Age, Rampage, and Charge. Plus Faceless.
Yeah.
So it's so 8.
It's 4.
11.
4, 8, 11. So it's 22 from 1, so it's 48.
Isn't it 52?
Yeah, something like that.
With Faceless?
Maybe if you have a weapon on as well.
Yeah, with the weapon is even more. Can you even Taskmaster?
If you get multiple reductions, you can even, like you said, Commanding Shout. Get Faceless, get through one of the taunts, even an Ancestral Spirit or Earth Elemental, and still be able to kill with the second one.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah, that's true. If you wait too long, I mean, it might just end. And, you know, this Shaman deck doesn't have nearly as much cycle as the Warrior deck. The Warrior deck's like, it's removal and cycle, and then combo. That's what it is. That's the only thing that's better in the deck, so.
That was a really awkward turn there for Skokja. He ended up playing the Ghoul on a Healing Totem. Yeah. I don't know what else he could have done, though.
Probably just to empty his hand a bit because he still wants to play Balorageous, I guess.
Yeah. We'll see a slam here most likely come down. Skokja. Or maybe he just decides to not care and sacrifice his ghoul, but
if you slam, you just cycle it one to one, right?
Yeah, you kill it off with X as well. If you slam.
Yeah, it makes sense. So how many cards do you have to hit with Thorisen to make it awesome? Like, you definitely, because Faceless is 5, then Worgen is 3, so it's 8, and
you
charges.
Do you play 2 Worgens, or do you play 1 Worgen?
2
Worgen, 1 Faceless. Okay.
I'm not sure how, I'm sure 2 Worgens, I'm not sure about, like, specific amounts for, like, Facelesses and...
Yeah, it would make sense to have only 1 Faceless.
Yeah, Faceless is almost always 1. Because Faceless is really, I don't know. I want to say that it's really hard to play, like, by itself. Like with the Worgen, I mean, you can play the Worgen without Faceless and still kill your opponent. You can't play a Faceless without Worgen and still kill your opponent.
Yeah, but still you can have some Faceless targets. Like sometimes in some matchups you can Faceless a Ragnaros or you can Faceless a Thorisen if you miss your own.
Yeah.
But basically Dan has to be a beat down in this matchup. He just doesn't have time. The thing is, like, he changed face. Normally in this deck you play Flame Rift Faceless, but Dan is playing Book Creepers now. So it's a bit of a slower approach.
Much slower. You're gonna beat him down with Halazeal.
Yeah, and a 1-1 totem.
Yeah, that's gonna happen. I mean, the deck, when you look at the deck, it just seems so weak. And like, if you play with like a faster deck and they draw poorly, like if they don't draw their AoEs, if they miss Elemental Destruction, you're like, wow, this deck is bad.
Yeah.
But then you watch like the last series with Dan versus Strifecrow, and you watch like in some of the slower matchups, and even in the faster matchups, when you do draw the AoE, and you think, how does anybody beat this deck?
Yeah, it seems unbeatable. But I think it's targeting specifically the aggro matchups. Like, you want to win versus Zoo to be able to just destroy their board. And and some decks just do not have the answer to the Earth Elemental with Ancestral Spirit. You just do not have Silence. You have no Executes. You have nothing to really deal with it. You only have minions.
So this is a pretty good Emperor turn, like, on paper, but it doesn't really have the key cards he wants yet to get reduced, like Charge, the Worgen.
Yeah, he hits only one card here. So probably just...
He has Faceless, and he has his Cruel Task. Most of the decks could be used. But so, other than that, it's kind of weak. So I would assume he's going to cycle more.
Yeah, this makes sense as well, because with this, he'll be able to play Battle Rage to draw one card at least before he goes... Like, you want to Shield Block because you want to cycle it, you want to draw cards, but also you don't want to have too much armor.
Yeah.
Oh, there's a Karen on curve. It's pretty good.
It's actually really good, because Karen is such a tough card, because you sort of have to kill it. You have to kill, like, the first iteration of it, because the difference between getting a Karen Ancestral Spirited and getting a Bane Ancestral Spirited is huge, because if you get a Karen Ancestral Spirited, it's like four fives.
But there's a huge flaw in Karen as a card. It doesn't have Taunt.
Yeah.
And that hurts, because does Oskaka really have to take care of this Karen?
I mean, I think so. Eventually, it's going to deal a lot of damage. I mean, at least it's going to take out stuff that's on your board. I think you always have to kill the first half.
It'll buy you some time, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I mean...
Ooh, what?
Yeah, it doesn't have taunt, so... Like, if you kind of...
Yeah, but it's a healing totem as well. I mean, he's saying that, like, if he Ancestral Spirits, it's fine.
I think it's great. If there's spirit on Karen, it's great. Because there is no spirit on Earth Elemental.
Yep.
Yeah, sure, but...
Yeah, I guess. I mean, he does have a lot of time. But he hasn't drawn, like, his key pieces yet. But he does have the combo with Wild Pyromancer and Commanding Shout.
He just needs to get, like, an Acolyte of Pain, and then the things will happen.
Yeah.
Man, the Acolyte of Pain with Pyromancer and Commanding Shout is so annoying. Like, they clear your board almost. Or just clear your board and then draw a lot of cards.
Yeah, their entire deck.
Like, what year is this? We see Earth Elementals, Commanding Shout being playable, those interesting decks. Coming to this tournament, I was talking to Firebat, and Firebat is like, yeah, everybody brought like Temporar, Zoo, Yogg Druid, and Aggro Shaman, and suddenly, well, we're watching those games.
So he has the opportunity to draw a lot of cards. Pyromancer, Blood of Ichor, Commanding Shout, and Battle Rage. If he chooses to.
Yeah,
and
I think
that's the play.
Yeah, you can go for it. Also, like, you do a lot of damage on board, so kind of clear.
Oh, I'm surprised they didn't play the Blood of
Ichor. You can still play it, and the minion will be
affected. Yeah, but then it will die, right?
No,
it's not affected.
It's all your minions that turn.
Oh, yeah, that's how it works. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Science.
So you could even play like a charge after and still be.
Yeah, that makes sense.
It's
OP, man.
Yeah, it's OP combo.
Apparently.
For years, people thought that Commanding Shout was bad.
So there's a full clear here. And he has the Worgen now. But I don't know if he wants to use the Execute here.
Probably not.
Yeah.
And what's the other? Can he play another spell? He can go for like second Commanding Shout, yeah. Just cycle.
Yeah. He knows that he doesn't need the coin because his Emperor is going to be sick. He knows that he has time to wait for like the sickest Emperor on the face of the earth. So really, no point holding out of the coin. You're not going to need the extra mana.
Yeah, he still needs the charge though, but he's almost done with the deck.
Yeah, I see the charge is a pretty important piece in the combo.
Let's see how many cards he has left. Like 5 cards left in the deck.
Yeah. Verna not getting as fortunate with the Farsight this time. In one of the matchups against Strifegro. He was the Earth Elemental on turn 4 with Ancestral Spirit. Absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah, that is really in trouble. Not to mention that Ostkaka almost has all the combo in his hand, but like only think from below for Dan.
Yeah.
Like even if you play think from below on this board, like you need to kind of clear it, or like, yeah, kill those minions.
Yeah, this is looking grim for Frodan, considering no Earth Elemental or Faceless inside. If he had one of those cards, then he could potentially get a strong wall, but
yeah,
I don't think he's going to have enough time, though.
Yeah, from Frodo's perspective, he might be just dead next turn.
Yeah, like Nimsh was saying, this is kind of like a deck that's, it feels like it's good against aggro because it has a lot of answers. It can buy time against just about every deck, but this OTK Worgen Warrior sort of makes their own time. They don't care about what cards you have. They're just trying to draw as much as possible, removing your board, and eventually they're going to kill you no matter what you do if you give them enough time.
It's actually amazing that we see this deck for the first time in the tournament, I believe, like this specific build, because I believe Aggro Shaman is good versus this, because if you get hyper-aggressive, you can kill them before they stabilize, but like Zoo is terrible. They have so many Whirlwind effects, and other decks, like people still try to figure out the matchup specifically, but this deck also like messed up the lineups a bit, because before you could ban, like you didn't have to ban Warrior, because you could target specific, like you could target Warriors with specific decks, but with now this deck in the mix, you have to ban Warrior because you never know what to expect.
Yeah, I feel like this deck also does really well against the newer Druids, like the Yogg Druids, because they also have a lot of tokens.
Yeah.
Like they have a lot of like Living Ruins Early or Violet Teacher tokens. You can sort of get rid of their board before they can make it big. And if they go for sort of that combo style play where they wait and then go for a huge Violet Teacher turn or like a huge Wisps of the Old God turns.
And they don't have taunts.
Give you a lot of time. Yeah, they don't have taunts, exactly.
I played that matchup on ladder. I was playing Yogg Druid a lot like recently, and I got so wrecked by those combo warriors. It's just like, just can't do much. Like, you need to rush them down. You have to have, like, Innervate, Coin, Violet Teacher, and turn one in the Power of the Wild, maybe with something else. If you don't, they just destroy you.
Yeah. So, has Frodan used the Hex yet?
No.
I don't think no. So, he would most definitely not use his Faceless here. It's a super gamble. That's probably what he's thinking about now. It's really good if your opponent do not have Hex, because you can remove the first.
I think you will not Faceless this, because Faceless will help you to win the game. So you might go for... Can you go double execute? Yeah, double execute.
You can, yeah. But it would be a strong... Like, knowing that he doesn't have Hex, it would be a pretty strong minion to Faceless there.
Yeah.
But he can't take that risk, considering he hasn't seen one yet.
Yeah. But Verdict's just kind of out of stuff.
Yeah, there's also board.
And if Oskaka's paying attention, he knows that the Elemental Destruction and Lava Shock in Dan's hand have been there since the beginning. So they're not minions. They have to be reactive cards. It's probably another reason why he wouldn't want to Faceless the Earth Elemental, just because those two cards have been sitting there for almost the whole game.
But Frodan still has a chance, though, because double Commanding Shout is out. This means like you have to charge Worgens and they will die. Double Execute is now out as well. So if you build up a Taunt Wall, like this turn he can only play like 1/5/5. But if he's able to like pull up with the taunt every other turn, maybe he'll find room to be able to survive. And if like charge is the last card in the deck as well.
He doesn't have many cards left. Yeah, he's only got 2 cards left, so charge is the last card in the deck.
Wow, that's really unlucky.
And now no executes, so can he even win the game is the question.
So how much damage is Worgen? Worgen with this is +4, so it's 4, 8, +3, 11. So it's 22 damage from a Worgen alone, so it's 25 of the weapon attack. And
how do you get through, though?
And if he gets through this, how does he get through the Bog Creeper?
Yeah.
The Golden Bog Creeper.
Well, it's even more because there's charge.
But he doesn't have Commanding Shout.
Yeah.
So he can't actually attack into the taunts.
And he can't get the Wind Fury effect from the Worgen because it won't be above.
No, he's good. I think he's good. Because does he have mana to play everything, though? Charge is like 3 mana, so it's 5, 4... No, he will not have enough mana to play everything. But if he'll be able to play everything, then he has OTK with like 2 Worgens. Like you attack in 1 Worgen into a taunt. And the important part is also like Froden is overloaded for 5 next turn, so he has only 5 mana left.
Oh yeah, that's true. That's actually a really big deal. No, he Lava Shocked at the end.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He Elemental Destruction, then Lava Shocked right at the end.
Oh, then he's not overloaded.
So, yeah, he's going to be able to play Bog Creeper this turn. And Oskaka might have thought about this, and that's why he tried to leave this Pyromancer with as much damage as possible. But now Dan can just Elemental Destruction and Bog Creeper.
That's big.
And then Oskaka doesn't even have a way to win. He won't even have nearly enough damage to push through a big taunt like that, will he? Well,
he can
just Worgen Charge and Cruel Taskmaster. That's not much damage at all.
That's the Shaman winning.
That's what 6 damage, back right? No, you can kill Creeper, but Creeper with one of the Worgens, and then you still have a second Worgen on board that goes face for some damage, which is 4 plus 2, 6, 8, 16, right? Because you have 8 damage Worgen on board, like 2 of them.
Yeah.
So with one Worgen, you kill a Bog Creeper, and the other Worgen goes for face. And it stays alive.
It stays alive, yeah, that's the big thing.
And you still have like a 2-2 minion on board as well.
Yeah.
There is the healing, so the healing can stall a bit.
So can Taunt Totem.
Yes.
So can any taunt in his deck.
Second Bog Creeper.
Second Bog Creeper. Second Thing from Below.
Earth Elemental.
Second
there's
Earth
one
Elemental.
More.
Ancestral Spirit, a Taunt Totem. That's bad, actually. Don't do that. Not recommended.
Oh, man. 16 damage to face.
It's really close, actually.
Can he kill the Worgen? Yeah!
Wow. It's still not over yet because he has to deal with the cruel. No, it's pretty much over.
Oh, come on.
Okay.
That's it.
All right.
That's some burn, Wolf.
Dan is now 4-0 in the tournament so far, all with Conceited Shaman. Is that conceded in any games today?
I'm just speechless, man. We did give advantage to Oskaka in the matchup, but he some like Bog Creeper. Bog Creeper, that actually was, I was just laughing. Yeah. Forsen, can you give us a professional analysis of that game?
I cannot believe what I'm seeing right now. Like meme warrior and Conceited Shaman in a tournament. I just don't know where to begin.
I'll paint you a picture.
This would never have happened in my time. Back in my days, we play normal decks.
A miracle rogue.
Yeah, go back to like, I don't know when ESGN was. What, 3 years ago now? 2 years ago now?
It's like 20 years at least.
When Dan was a young caster, back when he still had brown hair. I know it's hard to remember far back then, but
it was not on Tempo Storm. I don't remember this time.
If you had told anybody back then that fast forward 3 years, Dan is winning a high-profile tournament with... He's 4-0 with Conceited Shaman. Nobody would even know what Conceited Shaman is, first of all.
Well,
next, I would call you an idiot.
I'm rooting for Dan for two reasons. A, he is representing the caster community.
Amen to that.
And B, he is Team Horus. And we are Team Horus as well.
Am I? What am I?
You're the pleb one. The pleb team.
No, and I'm Horus.
Oh, you're Horus. Oh, sorry, Mel. So you're with us.
What is wrong with you, failure?
So we all can hate on Oskaka, who is Team Anubish.
Okay, it's fair.
But it's Sweden's pride, right? I have to root for him.
Well, you don't have to, really. We are in Egypt now, so...
I guess.
He got you on a technicality.
All right, I wanted to fire shots on Team Anubis, but... Let's let Froden carry the series.
All right, well, let's take a look at this matchup. So... This is going to be a... We haven't seen this deck from Oskaka yet, because he 3-0'd with Freeze Mage in his first matchup.
It's a ramp Yogg. Really,
yeah.
Most likely.
Yeah.
The problem is that... I was just going to say, his card draw is looking really bad right now, considering he used Wild Growth and had 2 Innervateds in his hand.
Yeah.
With that draw, it's really good.
Yeah, this deck is considered one of the top four decks at the moment, the Yogg-Saren Druid. And there's a couple of builds as well. Like, people still disagree on how many Ancients of War you want to play. Do you want to play Scenarios, or do you want to play Onyxia, or do you play both of them in one deck? That happens sometimes as well. Do you play double Mari Keeper? So there are still some differences, but everybody agrees that this deck is evolving around the ramp and Violet Teacher and Fandral, and has Yogg-Saren as a strong follow-up as well that can win games.
Zero Ancient of Wars, double Wisps of the Old Gods.
That's also a version of this deck that I think Jackie Chan was playing.
Yeah. That's the one that's more popular on Americas, at least as far as I know. That's the one that I play against mostly. I never see Ancient of Wars.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah. So, like, there in Europe, it's mostly Ancient of War, yeah. I guess.
I'm pretty sure this is the deck that, what's his name, Deathlore went like 9-0 in Valencia with.
Yeah.
It looks like it.
It's pretty absurd, especially since, like, you get ahead, it's almost impossible for your opponent to come back, because you make a board that's like, board sweeps just don't really exist much anymore.
You
make a big board with Violet Teacher, and they just can't deal with it. And then even if you fall behind, hey, you can still win.
Yeah.
Yogg-Saren.
Yeah, Yogg-Saren can clear the board, draw cards. There was an update from the pleb stream. RDU was able to win versus Mr. Yagut.
Okay.
And also Team Anubis is actually winning versus Team Horus, 800 to 400 something. So all the Team Horus guys, hashtag Team Horus, and send us your feedback, send us your well, good jokes and all the fun stuff you see. If you think Frodan is going to win, support Frodan with hashtag Team Horus, and bring it up, dude.
So that means RDU is 2-0 in that group, right?
I believe so.
That was the winner's match.
We've seen RDU win 3-0 with Zhu on the secondary stream.
Yeah, yeah.
Before,
yeah.
Versus LA.
Yeah, versus LA, yeah.
So he's through.
Yeah, he's through to the second group stage. Right, Nourish to draw some cards. You don't need any more mana. You definitely need something to fight back.
Soul of the Forest.
This matchup is so annoying for the Yogg-Saren Druid, because normally you want to have the board to use cards like Savage Roar or like whatever else you have, like
Soul of the Forest
as well.
Yeah,
yeah, but there are so many clears. At the moment, Dan doesn't have any more clears, only minions on board. So there is a chance for Oskaka to actually take over this. With no Ancestral Spirit, you should be able to deal with all those minions, but Oskaka doesn't really have like much minion generation at the moment.
No, it's looking pretty grim. His best bet is probably to stall for Yogg-Saren and hope it does wonders. I mean, he has a lot of spells in this deck.
Yeah.
He probably has some Raven Idols as well, considering he uses the legendary Druid 4-drop. But he's not going to have a lot of time, though, with the minions that Frodon has. He has basically only minions, no healings, no AoE, just pure strength.
Yeah. I like the attack there because I think he's going for Thorisson next turn, which will mean that if there's no Hex, then the 7-5 would probably die to Thorisson. Also, yeah. Faceless was a consideration, so you want to have those elementals at 5 health.
Yeah. There's not a reason to keep it up. There's no reason for you to keep it alive. But you would have to like want a top deck of Savage Roar or Power of the Wild in order for that to not be a trade-in. So.
Yeah, but now you can't play Thorisson. There is too much damage on board.
What?
So
you can play Thorisson,
and then you might just like he might just ignore Thorisson, go face.
Yeah, your other plays aren't—they're not very proactive. They don't really get you any further in the game. You're like using swipe. You're taking damage anyway because you have to hero power, and you're using Living Roots.
Well,
to have a clear board going into the next turn.
Yeah, exactly. I think like that's the other play, like Fandral, swipe, and. Innervate Living Roots.
Then he would leave one up, though.
Yeah, but then you're not dead, so...
Yeah, I suppose. This way, at least you're developing something. You're taking damage off the board, at least you're developing something. Oh, no, he's not taking damage off the board at all.
No, he's chilling.
Just going for Soul of the Forest, so...
I think that's the better long-term play. I was thinking about it, too. He's still going to have to trade into the 3-5.
Yeah.
And that makes for a really good swipe, actually, next turn.
Unless he goes face, because he can still have Hex.
Yeah, that Hex actually is quite useful. Drew doesn't really have any answers for this kind of shaman deck.
Yeah.
It's like mulch, but then you mulch an earth elemental that's ancestral spirited, and they get one back, and they get a card.
You know what's scary?
What?
Double ancestral spirit on one big minion.
Yeah.
But then face this.
I guess this is the only choice that Uskalka had, considering that the other deck is Zoo, probably, right? I don't think it's going to play Reno Lock.
Yeah, it's probably Zoo, and if that's Zoo, it's so bad.
Maybe if he realized that Frona was going to ban Mage, he could have banned this deck instead of the Warrior one.
Well, but then if Frodan doesn't ban Mage, then he gets screwed by leaving the Warrior up. So it's sort of the old conundrum.
Yeah. Also, Warrior can go, like, Warrior can win versus Druid and Warlock. Like, it's also not the best matchup.
Yeah. Well, this is as good of a clear as you're going to get. He's going to leave a couple stuff up, but now he's just out of stuff. And now that, like Forsen said earlier, going to try and play into the Yogg-Saron as much as possible. Hope that comes into your hand.
Yeah, he needs a lot of card draw. Not like card draw, but discovery cards. Kind of like the
Raven Idols.
Yeah, Raven Idols or the Mage card, 5-mana.
Ethereal Conjure.
Yeah, exactly. Stuff like that. He needs to refill his hand.
The problem is, like, with Yogg-Saron, like, Yogg-Saron is your only chance to survive this, probably. But still, you're unfavored with Yogg-Saron overall. That's because you're at 5, so there's a huge chance Yogg-Saron will actually kill you.
That's actually really good.
Question is whether or not you want to buff or taunt here. Because if you don't taunt, you're not going to have any taunt. You have one more Ancient of War at most. I'm not sure if you play 2 or 1.
Yeah.
Buff is more power, and you have to race. That's, I guess, your only way to win this game.
I mean, he does. He's got 16 damage next turn. So that would be lethal if Frodan doesn't either taunt. Well, I guess he would kill off anything. I mean, it still might be lethal if he doesn't taunt or kill any draws like Savage Roar.
Yeah, Frodan just goes for the big creatures.
Does he play Mulch in this deck? I don't know.
You normally play 1, but...
Oh, there's an Onyxia.
Also, he is playing the greedy version with both Onyxia and Snarius.
That's very greedy, actually.
They came in the wrong order, dude. Like, imagine Onyxia first and then Snarius above the board.
Yeah.
So he needs 1 damage.
Ancestral Knowledge can draw you cards.
It doesn't really have 1 damage except for Lava Shock. Right?
Lava Shock is Lava Shock.
And is that Distraction, Mana Tide?
No.
Well, he can still clear the board.
Yeah.
And then play a minion. I guess that makes sense still.
I mean, he's still probably going to win. Unless Uskalka gets Yogg-Saron. Uskalka needs a board. He needs card draw.
And then the more health.
He needs to deal damage. He needs to heal.
Perfect Yogg-Saron.
Perfect Yogg-Saron.
Oh. Unlucky, killing off his own.
Yeah,
minion there. There's the boss.
Well, it can be useful. It will be useful next turn.
Sure.
And Thorisan is a minion.
Pretty sure you want to attack the totem here.
Hmm. If you go face, I think
it doesn't really change the clock because he's gonna have healing and stuff. You want to get rid of these minions, right?
Got to factor Yogg-Saron into that clock.
Yeah, I guess.
Yogg-Saron always cast Call of the Wild. It's getting 1 damage closer to Call of the Wild lethal.
There is the Lava Shock, by the way. So getting closer and closer.
Oh my goodness, that was drawn 1 card sooner.
Yeah.
It would have. That would be over. Would have ended. Yeah. I mean, the game is probably still going to be over.
Still an awesome card because he was overloaded so much.
Yeah, that's true. So 2 5/5 taunts. I mean, I guess Uskalka does have a way to deal with it. He's got mulch.
Yeah, and he can actually...
He would have to trade in.
You have to trade.
Yeah, that's a little bit unfortunate, but maybe Dan can get something with a battle cry from this mulch. North Sea Kraken?
So, a charger?
So do you swipe here, if you have Yogg-Saron, do you swipe here preemptively and hoping to top deck it? That's 1 more spell and it's 4 damage.
Depends how many spells you've played. Because
he's thinking about it. How many cards does he have left, Uskalka?
He might be thinking that, yeah. I mean, if he thinks that he only has one turn left to live, then it's the right play because he gets one extra spell. Unless...
And four damage.
Unless he's feeling really sad about his chances and that one spell is the spell that kills him.
Well, the thing is, like, you've just mulched, so you know your opponent has a minion, so maybe Swipe will be able to kill that minion and save you. So just preemptive Swipe the face, I think, doesn't make much sense.
Yeah.
All right, Manate told him to do the cards, running out of minions, but he can actually kill the 3-3 here, and the totem devolve a 3-2. Not much, but it's something. Small things.
I mean, eventually Dan's just going to draw into another minion. So it's kind of a race between Dan drawing a minion and Oskaga drawing Yogg.
I think this is a good example why we call this deck a Concede Shaman. It really doesn't make... It doesn't win. Just you have to concede because like I can't win against it. But Oskaga still has a chance.
I thought it was called Concede Shaman because it was so bad that you just had to concede yourself every game.
I think that was also Frodan's impression for the first time I called it Concede Shaman. Yeah, but most of the time people concede to you. Okay. Like, you just build a taunt one, they're like, all right, I just lost.
Well, there's a Bog Creeper. And there's another Bog Creeper.
Four mana!
But you do want to play the more expensive one right now. Oh, he's actually going to hit it, okay.
He says he's
scared. He's scared of Yogg-Saron.
He says the only way I lose right now is Yogg.
Yeah, Yogg can do some crazy stuff. So Dan is, overall Dan is in a great spot.
Whoa.
And this might be over right here.
He's used both innervates, right?
Yeah, no more mulch.
Yeah, but it does, maybe I have a five draw. Oh no, there's that.
I think it's over anyway because you have Elemental Distraction, which does not kill your 6-8. So yeah, Dan is surprised himself.
Looking pretty cocky right about now.
It's like, what? 5-0 with Concede Shaman.
Dan just looked over at us for verification.
Beating
He's like,
the
am I
champ.
Doing it, guys? Am I doing it?
I want to confirm this is absolutely legal, what we are doing here.
What is watching Dan win?
And him playing this deck. All those cards are actually in standard, so this is a legal deck.
Yeah. You may not be seeing them very often. Farsight's not usually a card that's in a constructed deck. But Dan is now 5-0 at Seed Story Cup. He wins this next... Yeah, in his group.
The group of death.
In the group of... Well, a lot of people were calling it the group of death. Oskaga, Super JJ, and Strifecrow. You know? You got a world champion in there. You have a...
one of the best performing players.
Yeah.
And a top four world championship. Was it Strifecrow's top eight? Or top... Or top 16?
Top 8, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
And also, Super JJ was the one who beat Frodan in the top 8 at the last Seed Story Cup.
Yeah. The revenge.
So not only is the group of death, it's also a revenge group for Frodan, who, he's a super competitive guy. You know, you may see him cast, and when he streams, he doesn't try hard, he plays wacky decks, but...
Well, I was rooming with Frodan in Valencia. So we were going, catching Pokemons, like partying, and Frodan was just try-harding all the time, just... On call with Purple, talking about matchups.
Going, catching Pokemon, partying.
Dude, that's the dream life.
Oh, man.
But yeah, this matchup is exactly why you bring Concede Shaman to the tournament. You want to destroy the Zoo. Zoo has no silence right now. Crazed Alchemist doesn't do much against the 7-8 taunt. You just have to kill everything with damage.
They do kill Doomsayers, though, which the Concede Shaman has.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure if he even runs it. The Alchemists.
Might not, because the metagame right now is all about the tempo decks. So like Freeze Mage is not that popular. And
I mean, his strategy is going into this is banning Warrior. And he expects Aggro Shaman and he expects Sue. And there's not like a lot of great targets for the Alchemist there.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I mean, maybe Oskaga though was expecting more Freeze Mage this event. Because going into last year of standing, you usually expect a little bit more Freeze Mage than Conquest. Actually, a lot more Freeze Mage than Conquest, considering in Conquest it's almost non-existent.
Yeah, but then like Freeze Mage wasn't that popular at both DreamHacks, like DreamHack Valencia and Summer. Like, actually, the Temple Mage was more popular.
Well, I mean, it's hard to say, because at those tournaments, you don't see...
The whole field, just
80% of the decks, 90% of the decks, so... I know a lot of people were saying that I was talking to Ignite, and he said that he saw a few crazed alchemists at Valencia. And he was playing Freeze Mage. He said it was one of the reasons why his Freeze Mage was successful.
He preferred to play that over the Imp Gang boss. I guess that's fine. It's better to get that Hex than the Imp.
Yeah, also, you can... Can you increase its attack to...
You can't increase it that much at this mana pool, but it's still pretty good.
Coil, does Coil help?
I mean, it's better than...
Yeah.
No, I don't know, because he's going to tap this turn. Because you can't deal with the Doomsayer.
Yeah.
So the rest of his two mana is going to be filled with tap, so he might as well pick up like a Young Priestess.
To try to escape the range of AoEs. Yeah, Priestess might be better here.
Yeah. Because, he can use Mortal Coil to try and draw on the totem. But even if he draws Power of Overwhelming...
If he draws Power of Overwhelming, he will be able to...
He can do it then.
Okay, but I don't know if it's worth it. Power of Overwhelming would have to be your exact next card. Because if it's not, then you're floating one mana. You're not fitting in a tap. So I don't know.
It's a gamble.
Yeah. I think Young Priest is here, though.
If you get Abusive, can you do it? Like, Abusive is +3/+4. Abusive can also do it.
I don't think so.
Abusive can do it. Like, at the moment you will have... Like, if you coil the totem to the Mizzazi...
No, Abusive is one off.
Yeah, Abusive would be
Abusive one. Gives a +3 power on board. So it's 5, 6, 7, because you play one more minion. So Abusive would do it as well, I think.
He would play Ardent Squire Abusive, which would buff it by 4, and it was at 2. So he'd only have 6 damage to throw into the Doomsayer.
Yeah, but you also have Pulse Villager that can attack.
The Villager had to attack into the Taunt Totem. The one health
did it this turn or last turn?
He had it this turn, yeah. So he would have been one off.
Oh, okay.
Well, it was close.
Yeah. Good thing he picked that Mortal Coil, though.
Yeah.
Now we can clear that.
So I guess you just...
Wait, no, we can't.
Yeah, with Direwolf, Power Overwhelm.
Yeah, and Coil.
That's only 7.
It is only 7.
Oh, so he can't clear it, you're right.
He can't clear it, yeah.
He can't clear it, no.
So, now what? I think you just have to play, try and stick as much stuff onto the board. I think you have to play Imp Gang Boss here, because you want something to stick around. But, I mean...
Do you want to do the Power Overwhelming anyway, preemptively, in case he has the Faceless?
That's not a bad suggestion, but he will not have mana for Faceless, because he's overloaded.
That's true, but with a Lava Shock... No, he still only has 5 mana.
Yeah.
That's true, he doesn't need to think about that.
So I think Imp Gang Boss is a must, because you need to try and increase the chance that he keeps something around. I think Ardent Squire is also a must.
Ooh.
And decides to throw a Boardwalker as well.
Yeah.
Why the Squire instead of Flame Imp there?
Because
it's more sturdy to AoE, but it only has 2 mana. He could Lava Shock and Lightning Storm, though.
I guess with Squire, you'll be able to just kill the 7-8 and not lose the minion. Because you will have to charge something into this minion. So you will probably like PO the 1-1 and then play Direwolf Alpha between the 1-1 and the Squire as well.
I think he wanted to make sure that he would have 2 minions no matter what stick around. Because if he plays... Because Voidwalker blocks the attack into the Imp Gang Boss, which means he's always going to have a minion.
Yeah.
And Ardent Squire is always going to have a minion. So this is the only way, the only 2 one-drops that you can play that guarantees you have 2 minions for Direwolf Alpha next turn.
But it's weird in a way, because if he will have a Flame Imp, it will be better, because then he can kill the Mana Tide. Can he still kill the Mana Tide? 6. Yeah, he can still kill the Mana Tide because he has the Coil. So Direwolf Alpha between both minions.
Both of these minions are pretty awkward, though, to Power Overwhelm.
Like, you have to PO the Imp Gang Boss.
Yeah.
So we attack for 7 with Imp Gang Boss, and then attack for 2 into the Mana Tide and Coil the Mana Tide.
It just feels like such an uphill battle.
I would Power Overwhelm the Squire instead.
Oh, you're right. It's probably better.
Just more sturdy to AoE to have the Gang Boss if it's Lightning Storm.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, so do you leave a 1-1 up or...
I'm pretty sure you do play 2 Flame Imps here over tapping. You kind of want to force the AoE at some point.
And you might as well try earlier on in the game rather than later in the game.
I mean, this house gonna win if he plays 2 defensively.
All Alright, so he goes for the Flame Imps. Fingers crossed there is no AoE.
But there's two.
Yeah. Oh, free now.
There's three. Now the hard part for Dan here is which one do you use?
You can go in theory for Elemental Distraction and then play Doomsayer. You will be overloaded next turn, so next turn you only have two mana, but then there's Doomsayer.
Or you could, I mean, yeah.
Can you go for Storm at all? Like, that's the question.
You could go for Storm, for sure.
Storm would leave the Imbang boss in a 1-1. So you could still Storm and Doomsayer, and it'd be pretty likely that he wouldn't have a way to deal with it, since you've seen Direwolf Alpha.
There can be a PO. There can be like Dwarf, Abusive.
Yeah, that's true.
There's like a lot of ways. Or like Defender of Argus, Abusive.
Yeah,
there can even be a Crazed Alchemist in there.
Oh yeah, Crazed Alchemist.
Yeah, Crazed Alchemist like wrecks you anyway. I think this is safer.
It's much safer, yeah. So now he has to have PO plus something else, or just straight up Crazed Alchemist. And with Doomguards in the deck, I don't think you play Crazed Alchemist.
That's such an awkward draw because he doesn't really want to tap now, but he has to tap because he can't clear that Doomsayer.
Yeah.
He might just play that though and recycle that because he's going to discard cards anyway. I wonder if that's a...
I think it's not worth it actually. Just attack face and pass. You want to have those minions for Councilman buff. It's like next turn you play Councilman, Dark Peddler or something else. Dan is at 2 mana. Next turn he will have 8, so he can... If 6... Do you want to have 8 or 6?
I'm surprised he actually tapped or hero power there instead of drawing cards.
Well, if he has 8 mana next turn, he will be able to Storm and then play an Earth Elemental afterwards. So 8 mana is better than 6 next turn. And now the Councilman plays.
Yeah. I mean, this is going to eat another AoE, but the thing is...
Storm doesn't even kill it. It needs to actually use Elemental Destruction.
Yeah. That's really... it's not that awkward. It's just annoying. Because if that was his play, if he held on to Ancestral Knowledge last turn, then he really wants to protect that Earth Elemental. And that means he can't just play Storm and leave the Darkshire Councilman up. But this is such a powerful play.
Yeah, this is still pretty good. And the fact that he had a totem that was a guaranteed kill on the Councilman made it even better there.
Yeah. And he can't deal with it.
Well, there's a good point to that. That Dan will not have, like, Dan has one more mana next turn. Like, one mana overall. Like, he's overloaded for, what, like, 8. So he has one mana. So you know you have at least, like, 2 turns to have an action.
Yeah, so you just want to try and develop as much as possible this turn?
Maybe you go for a Corruption.
Maybe, yeah. That's actually...
Yeah, that's not bad.
A reasonable idea. Or we just start chipping away at it. Get those juggles. What else would be good from Dark Peddler?
That's good versus 7-8.
Oh, yeah. A tournament attendee. That's what I'm talking about.
Oh, he doesn't want to play the Knife Juggler. I'm surprised. Yeah, this is looking really bad for Ushkok, actually.
Yeah, this matchup, man.
This Conceited Shaman is doing God's work right now.
So now we can easily clear the 7-6.
Yeah.
You can actually play Abusive, Defender of Argus, and Doomguard this turn.
You could. Problem is that it's like kind of awkward. Because you don't really benefit from the Argus damage or the Abusive if you do that. Get in there and fight, maggot. I like this line of play though.
Yeah. You don't want to leave your board too vulnerable to that third AoE. So he could have like Defender of Argus and tapped again.
There is no more Elemental Destruction, but however there are 2 Lightning Storms.
Yeah.
Well, if you want to be fancy, you can copy the Doomguard.
Yeah, I think that's what he's going to do here. He's going to copy the Doomguard, he's going to Lightning Storm. And Lava Shock.
This deck just kills everything.
Actually, he doesn't need to Lava Shock this turn. He could just Ancestral Spirit his Doomguard if he wants.
And that's not terrible, actually, having a 5-7 charge.
Yeah, because you can actually trade it in.
Yeah,
and then just get another one to attack with again.
Just do it, Dan.
And look, Oskaka's at 14 health. So even though Dan's using a lot of resources to deal with this, he's really not. Because Oskaka's just using his health, and Dan doesn't even need to kill him. Because he's going to kill himself eventually by just tapping himself out of the game. And I don't know, unless both these juggles hit the Doomguard, Oskaka can have a
It did.
Oh, my God. Well.
Oh, this is still an okay situation for Frodon. Come on.
He can't Ancestral Spirit the Bog Creeper, though. So there is a window of opportunity for Oskaka here. He does have a PO left in his deck. He does have a Doomguard left in his deck. He probably has a Soulfire, too.
Maybe he runs a Leroy, too.
A Leroy also. Holy moly.
Well, you can Lava Shock one of the minions and then play the Book Creeper. And be like, deal with it.
Yeah, that's true.
You could also Lava Shock the Imp Gangbang boss and then Lightning Storm.
Yeah. That's also not...
That way you kill one more Imp, but you sacrifice some Overload.
And you can also clear the whole board doing that because your Searing Totem can then attack into the final Imp that spawns.
Yeah.
Oh, no, because Knife Juggler.
Yeah, Knife Juggler. So
it's a gamble, yeah.
Well,
yeah.
You can attack into Imp Gangbus with your 1-1. Like, you take one damage from the juggle, but then...
They don't guarantee that you clear the Imp Gang boss fully, and that would be the only reason to go for that play, is to start from scratch. So, and actually, I think you get two juggles from the Imp Gang boss. You get the first one, and you get the Storm one before the Knife Juggler actually fully resolves, because of the order. So, it'd be really risky. So, the Totem up first is good.
So I hope that Juggle does not kill your 1-1.
Yeah. Oh.
You catch for playing Hearthstone.
But I still like this play. Because I think the play might have changed based off of if he had where that Juggle went. He might have Lava Shocked and then cleared the last minion off with the Searing Totem. And Oskaka's running on fumes now. He has to tap every turn.
Yeah, and there's nothing else. He can't kill the 5-5 now.
I mean, he only has 5 more taps left.
Yeah, I think we're going to see a concede this turn here.
Even with
a Doomguard, you're not getting through.
Yeah. Oskaka doesn't concede very easily.
No.
So if he concedes, then it truly is
a concede shaman.
A concede shaman.
So Oskaka knows, like, this turn he doesn't kill the 5-5, it goes face. Next turn, he will be able to kill the 5-5, but then he needs to kill double 5-5, kind of. Like, he will need 10 damage to be able to deal with this.
Yeah.
There is maybe one more Defender of Argus in his deck.
Get it out! Get it out! The light protects me.
If you attack into the 5-5 with Imp Gang boss, you kind of like have more power, so it makes sense.
Yeah, I'm looking at Dan in the player area right now. He knows. He knows that this is over.
Yeah, there's like no way. The Book Creeper is too much of a minion. It's a big dumb minion, and Dan takes another one. He goes out of the group 6-0 with Concede Shaman. What?
Wow. So he's going to move on to the second group stage. 6-0. You know what? I want Dan right in the middle here.
Oh, man. Oskaka went to shake Dan's hand. Dan was like, Dan was already.
I got a spot for you right here, Frodan.
Oh, my goodness. Frodan. So you have the mic?
Yes.
All right, give us the Rap God explanation. Like last time.
First of all, I still consider, even though people like still have their favorite players, I still consider Oskaka like one of the top 2 players in the world, just technically speaking. So just a lot of respect to him. But the big reason why I won, I think, is just because I think this deck really counters things like the Druid and Zoo. I thought Druid and Zoo would be the 2 most popular decks at this tournament, and I don't think I'm wrong on that. So I just thought I really want to kill these 2 decks and just make sure I can do it. And the big challenge is just getting past that first deck. When he queued Warrior, I knew Oskaka likes to play Patron Warrior, so I was really scared about combo, but he got super unlucky. I said the only way I can win this at this point, because he drew so many cards, was if Faceless Manipulator or Charge was his last, it was his 30th card, literally, and he couldn't do anything.
It was.
So.
Charge was his 30th.
Exactly.
Charge
so, was last card. I was like, well, I saw that he drew Charge at the very last card, so I feel super fortunate because I won that. The other 2 matchups just played how it should, I think. Like, Druid has a really tough time removing Earth Elementals, and I mean, I did get some pretty good draws when I needed it. And overall, it just felt like, I needed to get lucky to win a couple games, but I felt like my strategy actually worked. And I think it's just like a really good thing to show that people just think like the meta's solved. They think that they understand the game of Hearthstone because they play a few games just maybe for a week. But those people can go eat a bag of nuts because those people really don't have any creativity and innovation. It's not like I created this deck myself, but the whole point is you have to think outside the box and maybe you're rewarded. Sometimes it won't work, but sometimes it will work and you look like a genius.
Let's talk. That was a really good RapGob explanation out there. But like, can we talk about the changes that you made in this deck? Because there are Flame Rift faces normally in the deck and you're playing Bog Creeper. So who did help you to build up this deck? Did you do it yourself? And how did the testing go?
And they're both golden.
They're both golden because it's Bog Champ, dude. You got it. Just when you play Bog Creeper, you just type Bog Champ in the chat.
I love it.
I mean, the person that really helped me assemble this list is San. He was like the guy that really like put the innovation behind it. He actually originally suggested a different list, but I mean, he was really helping put the fine tweaks. And also, I want to give a shout out to Ixar, the guy who is on the balance design team. He's the guy who was like saying like, I think Bog Creeper is like an underrated card in the meta, and we thought it was gonna be much stronger. In Arena, it's kind of nuts, and when I see it in practice, it's like 6/8 is just like a ton of hell to get through. So it felt like I wanted more Earth Elementals in the deck, and it kind of functions as one if you can get it Farsight, or you can have an ability to discount it. The one thing that I wasn't sure is how to squeeze an Emperor Thoris in the deck, but it just didn't fit, so I just went without it.
All right, that was an amazing performance overall, 6-0 with that deck, dude.
First I can't believe it. Like, what?
Yeah, what up, man?
Everyone's like, Rip Ronan. Where's all the forum haters now, man? Where's all the Reddit threads?
Oh, man.
Yo.
That was half the thread was people saying Rip Ronan.
They're like, I love Ronan,
but I don't know.
Woo. So, Frodan, are you going to pursue the professional career now?
I don't know, man. I might be one of the first people who started as a caster and just transitioned to a player career.
That would be awesome.
I don't know, man. Playing is super stressful. I have nothing to respect for players who can do it all the time. But again, it's not like I did this myself. It was a ton of preparation. Big shout out to the Templestorm guys, to Purple and Firebat, who helped me practice, as well as Casey, too. Yeah, he helped me a lot with the Rogue, but I never needed Rogue just now, so his shout out will wait.
Well, I really hope that we will see you playing other decks as well.
Yep, I'm a one-trick pony, man.
Oh, dude.
It was amazing. This deck lost so many games this morning. Like, I was like, okay, maybe one round of ladder before I go to the tournament. And I played like, I was like, okay, just win like one or two games. And I just lost. And I lost like 10 in a row. And I was like, oh, God, this is really bad. And I was losing matchups that I thought I should be winning. But, thankfully, it all worked out. And I kind of went back to the drawing board because I think I was... During the ladder session, I was doing too many like stupid plays, like thinking outside the box too much, and just play it to the normal game plan.
Nice.
The deck's really fun, and I really encourage anyone to try it.
Team Horus.
Team Horus, baby. Gotta eliminate all those Anubis scum plebs one at a time.
We don't have any.
Somehow Forsen got
on. I was just looking at Forsen because Forsen didn't say anything. I feel like
the whole couch right
say
now.
Something.
All right, guys. Do you have any questions for Frodan?
Are you going to carry the torch for the casters all the way to the finish line?
Oh, I'm sad because TJ was supposed to play too. Next time.
Right?
Yeah. TJ will show you guys how good he is at the game too.
And what about me?
And Nymphs too.
And Nymphs, you're like ranked 25 legend right now, right?
Rank 47, I think.
Yeah.
And Forsen, he also made the transition from player to caster.
Forsen, you want to be a caster?
No, I'm good. I'll be one of those underrated players.
Not the Thrawn bro.
Yeah.
All right, guys. That was awesome. And we will... I'm not sure what's in the program right now, but definitely more Hearthstone Seed Story Cup goes on. We will have three or even four awesome days of games. It's amazing. So, see you guys over the break.